Isaiah 53:5. When he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Then Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 20. Luke 2, 8 through 20. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said to them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even into Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning the child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen and it was told unto them. Did everybody get the candy cake? Don't think Sister Hill got. Could one of you get her a cane from the back there? It's on that back seat in the offering plate. Well, consider this morning a little bit of an object lesson and a little bit of a treat. The lesson of the sermon from the candy cane. And you know, this is a favorite time of year where we like to eat a lot of candy and buy a lot of gifts, and there's a lot of Christmas cheer. But there's a lesson in the candy cane. I'm sure we've heard, and there's a little bit of a saying there, the legend of the candy cane on what was passed out. And we'll summarize that later on this board. Now, just for a few minutes, I would ask that you would indulge me to chase a few rabbits. You know, as far as symbols or types in the Bible, you know, you look first of all at the numbers in the Bible. One being God's number, excluding all other numbers and independent of all numbers. God is supposed to be first in our lives. And then you have the number two, that is the number of difference. Two classes of people. You have those in Christ, you have those who are saved, and then you have those outside of Christ, those who are lost. The number two can also stand for the two Adams. You have the first Adam there, which failed and sinned in the Garden of Eden. And then you have the second Adam, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and who became the means of salvation. He was the second Adam. And then you have three, which is the number of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You have there three members of divine perfection. Four, the number of creation, special reference to the earth. Five is the number of God's grace. In fact, it has five letters, G-R-A-C-E. Six, that's the number of man. And the ultimate six is found in the book of Revelation. We all know that is 666. That is the number of the Antichrist, Satan's man, who will have rule and dominion upon the earth in the great tribulation. Then you have this number seven. That's the number of fullness. That's the number of perfection and completeness. Eight, the number of resurrection. Nine, the number of finality. finality and judgment. 10, which is the number of completeness and perfection in the divine order. Then you have 11, the number of disorder and imperfection. 12 is the number of governmental perfection or rule. For instance, you have the 12 tribes of Israel there. Then you have the 12 apostles. 13, the number of rebellion and apostasy. The number 17, the number of spiritual perfection or perfection of spiritual order. 40, the number of testing and trial. Jesus was in the wilderness 40 days and 40 nights being in testing, tried of the devil. And then you have 50, which I believe in the Jewish custom is the year of the Jubilee. Number 50, that's the year of salvation. And then you have typology. A type is a poor illustration of some scriptural truth. Now, a few types, the Passover lamb in Egypt, there in the book of Exodus, you could read about that, is a type of Christ. When the death angel would pass over the homes, and if the blood was not applied, then the firstborn son would die. The brazen serpent is a type of Christ. You remember there in the wilderness when they had their snakes all over every place. And when Moses would put the rod up and when people would look up, they'd be saved. The snakes had quit biting. But when he let it down, they would come back. Two birds having to do with the cleansing of the leper, typical of the death and resurrection of Christ. Then you have Jacob's ladder, Genesis 28. It's through Christ that God comes down to man, and man goes up to God. Manna is a type of Christ, Exodus 16. Jonah, a type of Christ, that he was in the belly of the whale or the great fish 3 days and 3 nights. And our Lord was in the belly in the earth for 3 days and 3 nights. Then the cities of refuge is Kadesh, Shechem, Hebron, Bezar, Ramoth, and Golan. They're the types of Christ. Now we get to the lesson at hand, the object lesson, the candy cane. You know, our Lord was a wonderful teacher, and he used a great deal of object lessons when he was teaching the people. The best known are the parables. It's often been called an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. And then he spoke there in Matthew 6:28 about the lips. He said, "They do not toil nor spin, yet Solomon, all of his glory, was not arrayed as beautifully as this flower." And then he gives many other lessons. But this morning, the candy cane, there's a few lessons regarding it. And I believe, if I heard right, the candy cane was originally made as a Christian witnessing tool or something thereabouts. Notice, first of all, the candy cane's not usually straight. It's got a crook in the top there. Now, first of all, the candy cane can speak of sin. And that speaks of a man in Psalm 58:3, "The wicked are estranged from the womb. They go astray as soon as they are born," speaking lies. Now, we're all born in sin, called original sin. We just didn't choose to sin one day. It was born, if you will, within us because we are of Adam's seed. What a picture there. All people born in sin, Psalms 51:5. "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin my mother did conceive." seed. Now, when little babies are born, we as Baptists believe that if they die in infancy, they go to heaven. We don't believe in infant baptism. They're innocent there until the age of accountability. But they are born in sin. And they come out of the womb crying. Crying as if to say, "Man, give me this, give me that, give me something to eat, give me my bottle," and so on and so forth. And Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Everyone else. All have sinned. And 1 John tells us that if we say that we have not sinned, or we say that we have no sin within us, we lie, and the truth is not in us. So everyone in here this morning, and everyone in all of Adam's race, is a sinner. Now there's a difference. Some of us are sinners saved by grace. We have come to the Lord for forgiveness, and we have asked Him to come into our hearts and save us. And those other sinners in the world have not come to the Lord. They are those that we wish to tell the good news. The reason that all men need a Savior is because we're all born sinners. We're all dead in trespasses and sin. And we're sinners by nature. Now, just because we're saved doesn't mean we're going to quit sin. The goal, though, is to let the better nature have its way. It's often been said, "Which dog do you feed the most?" You know, the good dog that's, you know, going to do right, or that old sinful nature. By the way, we've got that old nature within us, and we're going to fight till the day we die. But it should be the grace, the goal of every Christian, to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus. And God will help us fight that old nature. You know, the devil, he's going to be put in the bottomless pit for 1,000 years during the millennium. That'll be a wonderful time. No more devil. He really gets on my case and gets on my back a lot. I'm sure that he does with all this sport. But one day he'll be banned. Now secondly, we see that the candy cane can speak of the shepherds. You turn it also this way, and what's that? That's a shepherd's staff. Now, who were the first to hear about the birth of Jesus? Well, it was those shepherds abiding in the fields, keeping over their watch, keeping watch of their flocks behind. Now, we're going to get in more to the shepherds tonight in the third installment of our series on the characters of Christmas. But a few things about these shepherds this morning. They were lowly shepherds. They were considered ceremonially unclean. But it's interesting who God called. When God called Moses to be the deliverer or the emancipator there of the children of Israel out of Egypt, what was he doing? He was on the backside of the desert there, taking care of his father Jethro's sheep. He had grown up in the glory and the grandeur and the richness of one of the thriving civilizations of the day, Egypt, until he was 40. And we know how he left. He murdered there one of the Egyptians who was beating one of his kinsmen. And God would have to take him to the backside of the desert for 40 years in order to make him fit for the last 40 years of his life to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt. Also, David was a shepherd. You remember the story there in 1 Kings 6 or 1 Samuel 16, 11. What was David doing? Well, Samuel came by Jesse's. And he told him, I'm here to anoint the next king of Israel. Because Saul had messed up and fell out of favor of God. So Jesse paraded all of his sons there before Samuel. None of them was the one. He said, Jesse, you got any more boys? Yeah, I got a little shepherd boy out there watching the sheep. Go get him. So he did. Immediately he saw that he was the one. Now, we would have, David would have been the last one, I'm sure, that we would have chosen. All of his other sons were nice, handsome young men. And David was, according to the scriptures, in his own right. But he was the one that God wanted. You know, God takes the foolish things of the world and founds the wise through him. That's very true. Very true. The first recipients of the gospel here are the shepherds. And the ones that God chooses are not usually the cream of the crop of society. I guess the best exception to that might have been Saul of Tarsus, because he was pretty high in the echelon of Jewish society. Not many wise or noble are called, according to 1 Corinthians 1:26. It's a good thing that he comes to the lower place. Because not many of us are in the wealthy class. But he doesn't choose according to that. What does he look at? He looks what's in the heart. And then we see there were looking shepherds. They looked after the sheep. They looked at the glory. The glory of the Lord shone round about. What a wonderful starry night. What a wonderful, beautiful night there on the plains of Bethlehem. And then they looked at the angel who spoke. Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. So they witnessed the great heavenly host there. And what a thrill it must have been there, seeing that multitude of heavenly beings filling the sky all around them. And then they went looking for Jesus. They said among themselves, let us now go into Bethlehem and see this thing which has come pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. I think they were more than just curious. I think they knew within themselves that this, the Christ child, would be like no other. So they immediately left their flocks and they went there to that cave, and tradition says that it was a cave because it was the only place they could find where she could give birth. And now, and I've been there, there's a magnificent cathedral or basilica built over it. And we went to the very spot where tradition says our Lord was born. And then there's the life-giving shepherd. Psalms 23:1 says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I used to not understand that. I used to say, well, is that saying the Lord is my shepherd, I don't want him? No, that's not what that's saying. It's saying the Lord is my shepherd. If we're children of God, we shall not be in want, because he will provide for us physically and spiritually. We won't be in want. We won't be in need, is what that's saying. Well, the candy cane speaks of sin, and then the candy cane can speak of shepherds, and then thirdly, the candy cane can speak of sacrifice. Going back to our opening verse, Isaiah 53:5, but he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Now, a candy cane's very attractive because of those red stripes there that you see. Now, what does the red mean? Well, that's the color of redemption. It stands for the blood. God said in Exodus 12:3, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. The Passover, the last plague, the worst plague that God would visit there upon Egypt. And the Hebrews there were given specific instructions that they were to kill the Paschal lamb there for the offering. And then they were to sprinkle the blood there upon the doorpost. And there that night when the death angel would pass over, and when he saw there the blood on the doorpost, he would fly over and the oldest son there would be spared. But if the blood there was not applied, then the oldest son would die. And that's definitely a type. That's definitely a type of our salvation. We have to have the blood applied this morning to our hearts. And if it's not there, we're lost. And we'll die in our sins. How do we get that? How do we get his blood? Well, we ask for it. It's a gift, not of works, lest any man should boast. We can't buy it. Ephesians 2:13, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. Then 1 Peter 1:18, for as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. Then in Revelation 1:5, and from Christ Jesus, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, and to him that loved us and washed us from our sin in his own blood. So we see the candy cane speaks of sin, it speaks of shepherds, it speaks of sacrifice, and then fourthly we see that it speaks of sharing. Now you notice there's a little bit of white in that, even though it's more pinkish. White is the color of pure. White is the pure color. If we're saved, we have a message to share with those around us. Sins, our sins become white. Isaiah 1:18, oh come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow, though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Before we're saved, we have an ugly crimson color within us. And we need to be washed whiter than snow. Sort of reminds me of the snow here in these mountains. When it first snows, it's a pretty thing, beautiful white snow. But then when it starts melting, and then when we have to get out and go somewhere and we spin the tires, it's a muddy mess, isn't it? That sort of speaks of our hearts. When we sin, when we rebel against God, we need cleaning up. That's why we take baths, to clean us up, to clean our physical bodies. But our souls and our whole being be needs cleaning, needs washing by the blood of the Lamb. And he'll clean us. He'll cleanse us. He'll wash us. You know, the saints, the garments of the saints are white. Revelation 3, for thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. A lot of beautiful colors in life. You look through a kaleidoscope, and you see them all blending nice and pretty. But the color white is pretty. Because it speaks of the saints washed white as snow. You know, I don't know what we're going to look like in heaven. I just don't know. The Bible says we'll be known as we're known. But maybe we'll have white robes. I don't know. But I do know that that white speaks of righteousness. You got to have that to get in heaven. But there's a problem. Our righteousness won't fill the bill. It won't take care of getting us into heaven. We have to have the righteousness of God. That only comes through His Son, Jesus Christ. The only righteousness that I may have, and it's really not right, it's called self-righteousness. It's mine and your efforts at trying to look good before God, doing works and good deeds. And that just won't cut it. It won't cut it at all. We must ask for His righteousness, His blood to save us from our sins. Then fifthly we see, the Candy King speaks of the Savior, turn it upside down, you've got the J, that stands for Jesus. Personal name, he's known as Joshua, translation of the Hebrew Joshua in the Old Testament, it means Savior. But He's also the Messiah. He is the Christ. He is Jesus Christ. He's Christ Jesus. He's the Son of Man, Son of God, Seed of David, the Savior, the Lamb of God, the Lord of Lords, the Son of the Highest, the only begotten Son of God, the Chief Shepherd and Bishop, the Master, the Blessed and Only Potentate, the King of Kings. He's Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. He is our chief cornerstone, Head of the Church. He is our peace. He is our reconciler. He is a sweet-smelling Savior, Lover of the Church, Sanctifier of the Church, Lord of the Church, Image of God, God's unspeakable gift, Maker of all things, our spiritual rock, and I could go on and on with the names of God. And then finally this point, the candy cane could speak of sweetness. Now if you choose to eat this later, by the way, take the wrapper off first, but it'll taste sweet. Nothing sweet and good like a little peppermint. They used to give it to the youngins here in the mountains when they had a bellyache or around Christmas. Daddy used to say, old man Elliot Hollifield used to give them a little brown sugar and candy down there at the store. So it's nice and sweet. Psalms 34:8. Oh, taste and see, the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in Him. The candy cane is sweet, and God is sweet to us as believers. If we know Him, if we're in His will and right fellowship, nothing sweeter than sweet communion for God. But if we're not, if we're out of His will, if we're out of fellowship, then it tastes like old castor oil. I don't know if I've ever had castor oil, but they used to give Youngman's castor oil up in here, and I hear it doesn't taste too good. And you can say that if you're out of the will of God. I'd rather have a little peppermint, the sweetness there. So the candy cane, and these are good witnessing tools. It can speak of sin. It can speak of shepherds. It can speak of sacrifice. It can speak of sharing. It can speak of the Savior. And it can speak of sweetness. So I hope that you've got a little something this morning from the lessons.